The time is now 7 p.m. and I'm reconvening to open session and calling to order the regular Board of Education meeting for Indian Prairie School District 204 on Monday, December 14th, 2020. Jeannie, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Deming.
Present.
Mr. Rising.
Here.
Ms. Peel.
Here.
Mr. Razak.
Here.
Mr. Krubis.
Here.
Ms. Donahue.
Here.
Ms. Grover.
Here.
We are all present and we have a quorum. Mr. Rising, will you lead us in the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Rising. Our next regular Board of Education meeting will be held on Monday, January 11th, 2021. We do have a budget levy hearing at 7:05 that must start promptly at 7:05. We have a few minutes before that occurs, so I'm going to move to our board salutes. I'm going to ask that Ms. Peel share one of those board salutes.
Okay, two District 204 schools received distinction in art education. The board salutes Matilla Valley High School and Still Middle School as two of eight schools in Illinois to be recognized as a 2020 School of Distinction by the Illinois Art Education Association in the inaugural year of the award. The school's distinction program recognizes schools that demonstrate excellence in the areas of curriculum and assessment, authentic learning, showcasing student learning, connected communities, leadership and advocacy, and professional development and training. Congratulations to all our outstanding fine arts teachers at Matilla Valley and Still Middle School on this accomplishment.
Thank you. And then Ms. Donahue, I think we have another board salute. Ms. Donahue, you're on mute.
Sorry about that.
Yes.
So the board salutes District 204's lead web designer and developer, Greg Gibson, on having his article, Using CSS Custom Properties to Adjust Variables, Font, Weights, and Dark Mode, published online by CSS Tricks. The website provides articles written by content experts on CSS, HTML, JavaScript, and all things related to web design and development. It is the top 1,000 websites visited and receives more than 6 million views per month. Congratulations, Greg. Very cool.
Thank you. It is 7:04, so I'm going to wait for that minute, and then we'll begin the budget levy hearing. And the time is now 7:05, and I'm calling to order our budget levy hearing and any public comment or questions about our budget levy. I will turn this over to Mr. Strang.
Good evening, Mr. Razak, board members. Tonight, we take the final step in the process that ultimately will result in the extension of our property tax levy. The Illinois School Code gives authority to the Board of Education to levy a tax on real property within the district to support its public schools. This is an annual process that must occur before the end of December. Furthermore, the Truth in Taxation Law provides that the tentative levy and the levy exceeds 105% of the previous year's tax extension, a public notice and hearing are needed before the official levy can be adopted. Since our levy request represents less than a 5% increase, we are not subject to the Truth in Taxation Law this year. We still intended to follow the intent of the law. Therefore, 20 days prior to the adoption of this levy resolution, the school board estimated and announced a tentative levy for the amount of money that they deemed necessary to be raised for property taxation. This tentative levy that was approved by the Board of Education on November 16th, 2020 Board of Education meeting, and we are recommending that the board set that levy amount in $320,052,879, which includes the bond and interest levy. This levy is simply a request. While this represents a 4.2% increase over the 2019 levy extension, the district is subject to the tax cap legislation. We will not receive a 4.2% increase. In fact, depending upon the amount of new property, the district should experience an increase of approximately 2.87% in the final extension. It's important to note that this levy calls for a bond and interest tax levy of $27,287,288, estimated ending bond and interest levy in accordance with our bonded debt restructuring plan. Over the past 29 years, the property tax has faithfully limited property tax increases in the collar counties to the amount of CPI, and it continues to do so. The consumer price index used for the tax cap for this year is 2.3%. The district will therefore receive a 2.3% increase plus any amount of new property. With the tax cap, CPI has become the critical factor, not the tax rate. The tax rate is simply lowered or raised by the tax cap formula to obtain the CPI cap. Tax rates this year will drop as property values have increased in both DuPage County and Will County. DuPage EAVs have increased by 4.39% and Will County EAVs have increased by 2.80%. With the 2020 taxes, the average homeowner should experience a 2.3% increase in taxes paid to the school district, the same amount as CPI. The levy is set in amount to assure that the district is able to access property revenues from new property. This levy is based on the fiscal year 2022 budget forecast. Current projections for fiscal year 2022 suggest increased needs in capital improvements, and as the pandemic has greatly reduced our ability to budget for roof repairs, boilers, masonry, et cetera. The estimated increase in the property tax proceeds for the district will be $8.3 million, of which $1.6 million will come from new property. Later in tonight's agenda, we will ask the Board of Education to approve this resolution to adopt the tax levy as presented. This time, I'd be happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Mr. Strang. Questions?
So not a question, but I know since we have a lot of people online and this is such a important topic for our district, I just want to point out a couple of things. And Mr. Strang, you can validate or correct me if I'm wrong, but we compare ourselves to seven different districts and we spend the lowest per student out of those eight districts, including ourselves, and we're below the state average for spending per student by almost 10%. The maintenance but in the budget that we're approving is $3 million, which is down from $6.4 million last year and much lower than the $8.5 million that's recommended by our consultant study that we've had several years ago. So we're being very fiscally conservative with our spending in this district. And even though some people have picked up that we're asking for 104.2% increase that doesn't mean we're getting a 4.2% increase in our taxes. That's what we're asking for, but not what the average homeowner will have to pay. Our CPI is going up by 2.3%. And our union contracts, which are about 80% of our budget, are going up about 3.5% this year. So Jay, I guess I would like you to just repeat how much an average homeowner would possibly see as an increase with this new levy.
Thank you, Mrs. Donahue. You're absolutely right in your assessment of the school district. One other piece of information I'd like to add is that the property wealth in a school district really determines how rich the school district is as when it comes to local revenue. And our EAV per pupil is less than the state average. So our property value per pupil is less than the state average. And the real reason for that most is probably because we're heavily residential and we do have taxes on all of our property, commercial, industrial, railroad, and the homes. But when you're heavily residential, with those homes come students. So that's a burden for the school district. If Amazon had put its distribution center in the school district somewhere, we would have property value from that property, but we wouldn't have students from that property. Every year when I propose the tentative levy and the levy, I look at what the cost will be to the average home in the school district, and a $300,000 house is just short of the average of what we have for a home in the school district, but a $300,000 house with a 2.3% increase. And so the house is going to increase because its EAV is going up. And we're going to be levying more because we can levy up to 2.3% on existing property. The average increase on a $300,000 house is going to be $107. That being said, property values went up higher in DuPage County than they did in Will County. So it's not going to be an equal distribution. More burden is going to go on DuPage County than on Will County. And if property values on a certain type of house, like a townhome, are going up faster, and we have a lot of townhomes and a lot of desire to move into townhomes, the board has been very aware of that and been paying great attention to that, townhomes and apartments. If those property values go up by 6 or 7% and the single family homes go up by 2 or 3%, and then the property burden shifts a little bit from the single family home to the townhomes as well. So it's $107 if you could equally spread it out across the district, but there's a couple of things that are in play. How property values rise faster than others in different areas of the school district, if that makes sense. Either by the county, Will County to DuPage County, or by the type of home, a townhouse versus a single family home.
Mr. Strang, just one other thing, I'm getting feedback. I just wanted you to briefly also address, just because I think we have some people on here that came to hear about this as well, how Illinois funds schools differently than what we see in the rest of the country. The reason why, largely in part of why the burden on property taxes are so high for all Illinois residents is because Illinois, correct me if I'm wrong, funds public education 50th in the United States, I think at about on an average of about 24 to 26%, and therefore the burden to fund public schools falls to property taxes. And because we have the option to levy, we are also capped at that CPI. So can you just confirm that's a large reason, and that's why majority of people's tax bills go to fund the public schools, because of the state of Illinois and the decisions of how Illinois funds public schools?
You're correct, Mr. Rising. Illinois' tax structure is set up so that property taxes fund education. 5 or 6 years ago, Senate Bill 16 was a law that was being, well, it was a bill that was being proposed to change the funding system for education. And in that system, property taxes were going to go down to Springfield and get redistributed across the entire state. And in that case, if we'd have sent a dollar down to Springfield in taxes, we might have received 80 cents back, and the other 20 cents could have gone to Central or Southern Illinois. Sales tax is entirely for the municipalities. We could, if the county and all of the school districts in the county passed a countywide facility sales tax, we could get up to 0.5% of sales tax if we could pull that off, but it hasn't happened in the county, so that is not an option for us. We are heavily funded through local property taxes. Only about 13.5% of our taxes come from the state, and just about 3% come from the federal government. So this is our, by far, our greatest support of our schools and the most reliable support of our schools. The downside is that we continue to tax properties. The upside is that it goes directly to our schools. And in other states, it would go to school districts other than ours if it went down to the Springfield or the county seat or the state seat.
Jay, along those lines is regarding funding, can you also just share where we stand from a tier standpoint and what that means for us compared to some of our comparable districts regarding how we fund, where our funding comes from?
Yes, as I mentioned earlier, we're heavily residential, and we have a lot of homes and a lot of townhomes. And townhomes are the more popular new home that's going up in the school district. And as you know, the densities are much higher. So when you're taxing on that property, you're also getting more kids than you would from a single family home. So if we had more property value per student, we'd have more money to spend on each of our students. We actually spend less per student than any one of our comparable districts. The difficulty is that when you're heavily residential and you've got a lot of students you're pulling in, you've got to spend your money wisely. And so the state looks at what available funds you have and how much money they can actually give you from evidence-based funding formula. And they've got a number of 27 criteria that, you know, if you could implement all 27 of those areas, they would say that you were successfully putting into place all of the research practices to have a superior school system and to offer all of the programs that are needed. Presently, we're 80% funded, which means that with our local taxes, our state taxes, and our federal taxes, we're only have the opportunity to implement 80% of those areas. Our other seven comparable districts are either tier three or tier four, so they can implement much more than us. And three or four of our comparable districts, the tier four school districts, are over 100% funded, which means they could implement all of those domains, those 27 domains, which includes like class size, number of LMC directors, number of nurses in your schools, the size of your building, extracurricular programs for kids who have needs in certain areas, whether it's gifted or ELL or special education. They can implement all of those and still have money left over. We presently cannot implement all of those. So we're a tier two district, which means that the state is supposed to give us more money, but there's one tier below us, which is tier one. And since evidence-based funding has only been in place for, I think, 3 years now, this is our fourth year, they've been filling the buckets of the tier one districts and trying to give some to the tier two districts. Then the pandemic hit and the state's in a struggle. So they're struggling to increase the tier one school districts, let alone the tier two school districts. It doesn't hurt the tier three and the tier four because their local wealth is so much greater that they can implement all of those things right now without any additional funding, if that all makes sense.
Jay, thank you. Thank you for that, because that truly helps. I'm hearing feedback, but that truly helps explain why the decisions that we have to make regarding our budget, and we have to really look very carefully at each level that we spend on because we don't have that access. So I really appreciate that for our constituents. Thank you.
One other comment. I'm going to borrow from Mr. Karubis's analysis before. It still is correct that we basically have received very limited CARES money to support the extra things that we have to provide in the district to deal with COVID, which equated to about $40 per student. Is that still correct?
That is correct. We received about $1.1 million in CARES Act money. And Matt Shipley, who you just recently approved to take over for me when I retire, and I have been talking about, and Matt has done an exceptional job at the end of last year and through this year to track our expenditures and our revenues, because they are different because of COVID-19 and the pandemic and what's happening with the state and our community. And so we're seeing our spending going up in certain areas, in licenses for software, for technology, for bandwidth. We're seeing our revenues go down in the collection of taxes. Usually we're close to 99.8% of our taxes being collected. They're actually down now, about $2 million. So we're off there. We're spending less in substitutes because first of all, there's less subs who want to sign up at the present time. And without being in person, we're not spending money on substitutes. So we're really trying to track all of these variances that now occur because of COVID-19 to make sure that we have a balanced budget at the end of the year. Certainly there's some areas we're spending less in that we didn't expect to, but there's also areas that we're spending more in that under normal conditions we wouldn't have.
Other comments or questions? No one has signed up to provide public comment for our budget levy hearing. As a result of that, then, I need a motion to come out of the hearing. Please identify yourself.
Mark Reisling, I make a motion to come out of the levy hearing.
I second. It's Lori.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none. Jeannie, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Reisling.
Yes.
Ms. Donahue.
Yes.
Mr. Karubis.
Yes.
Ms. Peel.
Hi.
Ms. Grover.
Yes.
Ms. Deming.
Yes.
And Mr. Razak.
Aye. Motion passes. We are out of the hearing. We will now move on with the meeting. Our next item is our student representative report. Today it will be provided by Shaun Fieldman from Neuqua Valley High School. Welcome, Shaun.
Good evening. My name is Shaun Fieldman, the NV Student Council's School Board Representative, and it's my pleasure to represent Neuqua tonight. On National Sign Day on November 10th, Neuqua proudly honored 15 students who have signed letters of intent to continue to pursue athletics at the collegiate level. Congratulations to those students, and we wish you the best of luck in your next challenge. On December 3rd, the Neuqua Media Department posted its annual red carpet rally to honor student accomplishments throughout the year. Despite not being able to celebrate in person, Neuqua is proud to acknowledge its amazing students and their many achievements. With the holidays fast approaching, the Wildcat community has embraced the season of giving. Neuqua Student Council is currently hosting its Holiday 204 collection drive by collecting in donations digitally via Pushcorn. This annual event collects money for families in our district to help them through the holiday season. The Alliance for the Children tag drive has also returned for its 22nd year to Neuqua Valley. This drive allows students to use secure online stores to donate gifts to children in our region. On December 7th, the Neuqua School Counseling and Social Work Department hosted a virtual academic planning night. This provides aid to students in preparation for course selection for next year and for college and career readiness. Thank you to all the faculty and staff who worked so hard to host this event, and thank you to them for their continued dedication to Neuqua students. And lastly, the Neuqua Music Department began premiering its annual Crystal Concert on December 13th. Virtual concerts are posted each night at 7 a.m. on YouTube, with new performance being posted each night through December 19th. Congratulations to all the students and teachers who worked so hard to make this possible, and we look forward to watching you perform. That is all for this Neuqua Board Report today. Thank you all so much, and as always, go Wildcats.
Thank you, Shaun. At this time, let me give the explanation of why we're in a Zoom meeting. As you know, boards of education are bound by strict provisions of the Open Meetings Act. As board president, I have determined that an in-person meeting is not practical or prudent due to the pandemic. With the onset of the COVID-19 virus, some of the OMA guidelines have been relaxed. Specifically, board members do not have to be physically present. As a result, video or audio conferencing is allowed. Boards are encouraged to provide video or audio access to the meetings in order that the public may monitor the meetings. All other open meeting requirements remain in place. Quorum of the board must participate. All meetings must be open to the public, except any portion of the meeting that is closed for one or more reasons of the act. The meeting must include an opportunity for public comment. Requirements relating to meeting notices, agendas, and minutes remain applicable. Please know that our board will continue to meet these requirements in these most difficult times. Now move on to the agenda. It would be time for public comment for non-agenda items. To be transparent, we've had one person sign up. Their reason to sign up was unable to determine until the start of the meeting. We even attempted to call that person. If that is you, please call us back. If it is a non-agenda item, we will be sure to include you in our meeting. We have several people signed up for items related to the agenda, and we will take that public comment before that item. So it will be time now for me to move on, and we move on to our consent agenda and superintendent report. We will start with the superintendent report. Dr. Talley.
Thank you, Mr. Razak, members of the board, and the Indian Prairie community. I want to start off my comments tonight to congratulate three of our teachers who recently were awarded the A-plus award that is given out through the Indian Prairie Education Foundation and through a generous donation from Wells Fargo's advisors. Our December A-plus winners are Ms. Erica Pavlik, Neuqua Valley High School, Mr. Patrick Clifford, Hill Middle School, and Ms. Mary Zalabak, Nancy Young Elementary School. These teachers were nominated by families of students they teach, and I want to thank those families for taking the time to recognize the great work that these teachers are doing. None of these awards would be possible without the partnership we have with the Indian Prairie Foundation and the Wells Fargo advisors. Each year, Indian Prairie participates in a holiday giving program to support homeless and low-income families. This year, we achieved record-setting donations. We were able to raise more than $45,000. That money will allow us to support 204 families this year. That far exceeds the number of families we were able to support last year of 132 families, and in 2018, we were only able to support 84 families. I want to thank everyone who made donations online through IPPC, the Samaritan Network, which donated more than $7,000, the Neuqua Valley Student Council that donated $3,000, Grace United Methodist Church and DuPage Credit Union each donated $500, and we still expect a few more donations. This caring is what is good about Indian Prairie and our community. Yesterday, we just learned that Indian Prairie received a mini grant from the School Superintendent Association for $2,500 to support families who are part of our McKinney-Vento program. Tonight, I want to talk about one person, though he'll be working with us until January. Tonight is the last Board of Ed meeting where I can publicly thank Mr. Adam Smeets for the work he has done serving as our Chief Technology Officer over the last 2 years. He joined us from working at Dominican University and came in with a wealth of knowledge and expertise about not just technology, but on how to interweave technology with curriculum and make it an integral part of instruction, not as an add-on as it is in many places. He was instrumental in our movement to one-to-one laptops for grades 2 through 12, and was instrumental in our move to our much needed new student information system. Though his last day will be January 7th, he will always be a member of our Indian Prairie family. Mr. Razak, at this time, I would like to ask the board to approve the new Chief Technology Officer candidate, Mr. Rodney Mack. Mr. Mack is currently the Executive Director of Technology at Wheaton-Warrenville District 200. He has roots here in Indian Prairie, where he started teaching as a third grade teacher and then became a library media center director. We had more than 70 candidates for the position, and Mr. Mack rose through the ranks to be our selection. I ask the board to approve this candidate. Back to you, Mr. Razak.
Thank you, Dr. Talley. I need a motion to approve Rodney Mack as the Chief Technology Officer as presented.
I move that the board approve Rodney Mack as the Chief Technology Officer as presented.
I do have a motion. Is there a second? Please identify yourself as you make the motion.
This is Kathy Peel. I second.
I have a motion from Natasha Grover and a second from Kathy Peel to approve Rodney Mack as the Chief Technology Officer. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, Jeannie, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Grover.
Yes.
Ms. Peel.
Yes.
Mr. Karubis.
I'm going to abstain for the sole reason that we attended Waubonsie Valley together.
Mr. Razak.
Aye.
Mr. Rising.
Yes.
Ms. Deming?
Oops, sorry, aye.
Ms. Donahue?
Aye.
Motion passes with 6 ayes, 1 abstention. Congratulations, Rodney, on your new position starting in July. Dr. Talley, is there any further report?
Not at this time. I'll speak a little bit more when we get to the reopening plan.
Thank you, Dr. Talley. We now move to the consent agenda items. Please identify yourself as you make your motion or second. I need a motion for the approval of the consent agenda items E through K.
This is Natasha Grover. I move that the board approve consent agenda items E through K.
Lori Donahue, I second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none. Jeannie, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Grover.
Yes.
Ms. Donahue.
Yes.
Mr. Razak.
Aye.
Ms. Peel.
Aye.
Mr. Rising.
Yes.
Ms. Deming.
Aye.
And Mr. Karubis.
Yes.
We will now move to our discussion item, the reopening of schools. We have several people who want to make public comment. It is now time for public comment for agenda items. 30 minutes is allowed for public comment, and each person is limited to 3 minutes. When addressing the board, we ask that you respect the confidentiality and safety of our students and school district personnel. We also ask that those addressing the board be cognizant that this is an open meeting and is available to all age groups, and such as that you consider who the audience members are this evening and keep comments age appropriate. Public comment represents the voice and the opinion of the speaker. There will be no feedback from board members during the meeting, but follow-up will be provided by an administrator as appropriate. As mentioned, we have several people signed up for public comment. I am taking them in the order in which they have signed up. If we cannot get to everyone after 30 minutes, please feel free to contact us at board-members@ipsd.org. board-members@ipsd.org. We take the correspondence that is given to us very seriously. We do make a conscious attempt to acknowledge every bit of correspondence that is sent to us and usually send back a response. So again, board-members@ipsd.org. With that, we will begin our public comment. Our first speaker is Richard C.
Hi, everyone. This is Richard Catazon. I've lived in Naperville for 20 years. Moved here because my wife got a job as a teacher in District 204. We now have a son, Chase, in fifth grade, who has autism, and a daughter, Olivia, who's starting her freshman year in Neuqua Valley High School. When this pandemic hit 9 months ago, there was a lot of unknowns and a lack of a playbook on how to deal with this. Can you guys hear me?
Yes. Yes, Richard.
Sorry. Reactions at that point were justified, but in 9 months, so much has been learned. I want to call out the wonderful rally that was put together yesterday by IPSD 204 parents advocating for choice group. We are asking for a choice. The default of everyone remote is not a choice. It's a draconian directive. The information and discussion was outstanding, with many brave speakers making great points, even the youth. We were informed that the board and superintendent were invited to attend and none did. That's a shame. Since none attended, let's review some highlights. Very simply put, education for our youth absolutely needs to be of paramount importance. Education itself is much more than the regurgitation of info across a video call. It is all the interactions, socializations, and life skills that our children learn in their formative years. There is solid data showing how important in-person learning is to our youth and how destructive only remote learning can be. There is solid data about the depression rate and suicide rate spiking for our youth in time they have been made to sit in their homes. The hardest hit are special needs children and resource-challenged families. It's brutal, and it's a terrible place for our community to be in service of our most in need. Schools have been proven to not be super spreader environments. The political leadership in this country and state have no problem crowding people together into stores, but when it comes to the education of our youth, the best we can do is have them stay home. There are many schools, not only nationwide, but also local, whose leadership have stepped up and have been going to some of in-person school most of this year. It has been working, and their children aren't missing a beat. This leads me to my major point for the day. The best of leadership this board and superintendent can come up with in 9 months from the start of this pandemic is for everyone to stay home. This is shameful and shows a complete lack of leadership. The community of a well-respected school district such as IPSD 204 has to rally. I don't want to rally. No one wants to rally. That's a sign that things have gone drastically wrong. We recently finally received news to prepare to go back in a hybrid model. I need to remind the board and everyone listening that this has been proposed 2 to 3 other times, with actual preparation to only pull the rugs from under our children. This proposed hybrid solution is what should have happened back in September, so quite frankly, at this point, it is a half measure. The request here is for the board and superintendent to do what you were elected for and hired for. Be real leaders for a school district that has a history of being shining beacon to other school districts. We have wonderful teachers, so give them tools and support to teach in person and remote at the same time. There's been a long trail of excuses from the leaders, and quite frankly, there is room for no more. Get our children back into school with the services they need now and do it with a choice. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Richard. Our next speaker is Michelle D.
Good evening. I'm a middle school teacher in District 204, and I'm speaking tonight to ask you to reconsider the expectations placed on teachers for the hybrid plan. The expectations that teachers can simultaneously teach three different groups of students while keeping all three groups in the same place in the curriculum is unrealistic. For in-person students, teachers will have to make sure students have all the supplies they need, figure out how to get supplies students are missing without sharing things, make sure they are social distancing, have their masks on, and they aren't touching things they aren't supposed to. We have to make sure they can understand us while speaking through a mask, that they are understanding the lesson, doing the activities, and staying engaged. While this is going on, teachers are expected to maintain a Zoom classroom as well. Teachers will have to make sure all students are admitted, that they can see and hear what's going on, monitor the chat for questions, readmit students who have been kicked out, not admit students who are trying to Zoom bomb, make sure there is actually a person behind the black box, and they are all staying engaged. They need to make sure Zoom kids can find the materials to keep pace with the in-person students are doing, and making sure they are understanding the lesson as well. All of this on top of the expectation that we deliver high-quality, engaging, interactive, rigorous lessons that keep all three groups of students in the same place in the curriculum. Unfortunately, the solution for many teachers to this unrealistic expectation will be to have the in-person students simply bring their Chromebooks to school, sit in the classroom, and do the same remote lesson the kids are doing at home. Teachers have to maintain their sanity somehow. I do not think this is what parents and students had in mind when they signed up for in-person instruction, simply doing the same lesson at school that they could do at home. This model doesn't even account for some classes like music or band that won't allow students to even play or sing while at school because of the safety measures. Those students will literally have to sit there and do nothing while students at home are able to play and sing. What is the point of coming to school if it is no different or even less than what students can do at home? I can get much further in my curriculum if I focus on one group of students, the ones that are in front of me. If I can give my full attention to my in-person students, I can answer all their questions, do interactive fun activities, and do what I love, while my at-home students are working on an independent activity. Then the next class, I can repeat that same lesson to my Group B students, making sure they understand the lesson and give them my full attention. This also allows me to assess my students in person without wondering if they are just looking up answers, and I'm allowed to cover the curriculum more in-depthly. While I'm teaching to my in-person students, the other groups can Zoom in and listen. It never hurts to hear things more than once. Then on Mondays, I will give my full attention to my remote-only students, making sure they understand the material and keep them up to pace. This would be even better if the remote-only students could have remote-only teachers, but I understand the strain on personnel. And I wish we could all be in full-time classrooms 5 days a week. We teachers have done everything you have asked and then some. We teach to faceless boxes. We have reinvented our entire curriculum. We have persevered. But this expectation just may send many of us over the edge. I want more than anything to be back in the classroom, but not under these circumstances. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Michelle. Our next speaker is Lillian N.
Hi, my name is Lily Norman, and I'm a seventh grader at Gregory Middle School. School is essential. That's the simple way to say it, but really, it's not simple at all. Well, it should be. Since I was little, I was always told that the school and teachers wanted what was best for me. So my question is to you, why can't I go back to school if it's what's best for me and my education? In my opinion, I think we should be given the option to go back to school in person and full time. Every day is a struggle to get up out of my bed only to log on to a computer and sit on a Zoom call watching the teacher talk. This personally affects me because until a few days ago, I was failing math. The only reason I'm not failing anymore is because I had help from my mom, who was a high school math teacher. And I feel bad for the kids who are struggling just like me, but they don't have the help that they need. We are not getting the same level of education as if we were in school. The worst part of it all is I have zero motivation to get out of bed every day, and I get very frequent headaches. At least when I was in person, I had my friends to look forward to seeing at school, even though I never liked school all that much. But this has made it 10 times worse for me. I asked my friends if e-learning was hard for them, and 9 of the 10 people I asked said it was hard and that they wanted to go back to school. I would like to have a couple of my questions answered. First of all, when are we actually going back to school? Because it seems every time I have any hope whatsoever of going back, my mom gets an email a few hours later saying that we're not going back for another month or so. So tell me, what's the real truth? And why can't this be as simple as if I were to go to a private school? Some people might say that we should not go back to school, but I disagree, and that's okay. We, as students, should be given the choice if we want to go back to school or not. Every kid deserves to go to school in person, and isn't that why Naperville was ranked one as the third best city to live in the U.S. because of its top-notch public education school system? In my mind, it sure doesn't feel like that anymore. As Richard Branson said, you don't learn by following the rules. You learn by doing and falling over. Thank you for your time.
Lillian, thank you. Our next speaker is Laurel G.
Hello there. My name is Laurel George. I appreciate the opportunity to speak in front of you all today. Some background about myself. I am a parent of four children who have attended schools in the District 204. They have all been at Welch since kindergarten, and then they transitioned to Scullin Middle School. And I have currently a junior and a freshman at Neuqua Valley, and I have two children who are off in college. The reason why I'm speaking today is not solely because I am a parent and I have a vested interest in wanting the best for the children who District 204 serves. I'm also a pediatrician in this community. I am one of the six doctors at Children's Health Partners in South Naperville, not too far away from Neuqua Valley High School. We've been there for 20 years. I also serve as a part of Team IPEF and try to do anything that we can to support District 204. Since this pandemic started, because of my position as a healthcare provider, in the beginning of the pandemic in March and April, it was extremely frightening for not only myself and my fellow physicians, it was more so terrifying for my nurses that were still attempting to provide the best care we could to the children in this community. We have to adapt like any successful business has had to do during this pandemic, and made a number of different changes. We were thankful to have been able to take advantage of the several government opportunities. When initially, we really did not know if we were going to be able to, if we were in a position where we would be getting COVID from patients. Our nurses were terrified. We have had a very positive experience. What we've learned is that healthcare providers are not getting COVID from their patients in the outpatient setting. They're getting it from what they choose to do in their personal lifestyles. I tend to think, as a sister of an educator, that the same holds true in the school arena. Children are not giving COVID to teachers. Teachers are getting COVID because of what they choose to do outside of the school district. I think in my office specifically, we have seen a significant decrease in school performance based on the current school requirements here in Naperville. We have also seen, which is the most concerning to me, an overwhelming need for mental health in our youth. where I was used to seeing maybe one
or two children. Mr. Razak, the speaker's time is up.
Oh, thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Chairman. Thank you. Our next speaker is Brad W.
Hello, my name is Brad Walker. I'm a District 204 parent of a Mattia High School senior and a still middle school eighth grader. I run a campaign website called free204kids.com to advocate for opening District 204 schools, which has received over 5,000 unique visitors. At Sunday's successful rally to reopen District 204 schools, where hundreds of concerned parents and students gathered at the district offices, Paul Vallis, the former CEO of Chicago Public Schools, metaphorically described the actions of Superintendent Talley and the school board as holding our students hostage. In my 3 minutes, I'll explain why his statement is more than just a metaphor. As a school board and superintendent, you have actually exceeded your legal authority granted to you by Illinois law and simply do not have the ability to involuntarily quarantine completely healthy students for 9 months and counting. The law is designed to keep only contagious students isolated and away from school, yet your policy keeps all students away from school. Your policy violates the intent of the law and is unprecedented. Illinois legal code provides for the authority of local school boards related to infectious disease policies and rules. It states, and I quote, such policies and rules must include the evaluation of students with a chronic infectious disease on an individual case-by-case basis. The illegal policies implemented by the District 204 School Board are not based on individual cases of infection, but rather the prohibition of all students to attend school regardless of health status. Requiring all students to remain at home is not a case-by-case policy. Until COVID-19, quarantine was something required of the sick, not the healthy. Somehow, this fundamental principle has been turned upside down. In Illinois Administrative Code Title 77, General Procedures for the Control of Communicable Diseases, it states, and I quote, except in an emergency, the occurrence of a case of communicable disease in a school should not be considered a reason for closing the school. The only city, county, or state declaration of emergency related to COVID-19 was limited to the early days of the pandemic and has long since expired. District 204 is in violation of this Illinois Code of Procedures for schools. The students and parents of District 204 demand that the superintendent and Indian Prairie School Board immediately cease their illegal actions and open all District 204 school facilities to full-time in-person learning 5 days per week. Remote learning should be a choice, not an involuntary illegal requirement of a school board that has exceeded its authority over
Mr.
students.
Mr. Razak, the speaker's time is up.
It's Mr. Weiser,
of District 204 from their involuntary quarantine they have suffered since March. I invite those listening to this board meeting to visit free204kids.com and 204choice.com to learn more about the effort to open District 204 schools to full-time learning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Brad. Our next speaker is Karen O.
Good evening, my name is Karen O'Toole and I am a concerned parent. Our teachers are overworked and frustrated. Parents are stressed, but most importantly, our children are failing. They're failing academically, socially, and emotionally. I'm the mother of two students in the district. I have a seventh grader and I have my Patrick, who is a fifth grade special ed student in a self-contained classroom. And if you need to find me Monday through Friday between the hours of 9 and 3, I will be sitting right beside Patrick helping him e-learn. I have been doing this since March, and I will continue to do it as long as I have to because I refuse to sit back and watch my son fail. We are lucky. We are able to get by on just my husband's income. Many families in our district are not that lucky. To say that you are providing every child in our community an equal education via remote learning is simply not true. The high level of parent involvement required to support remote learning is not unique to the special ed community. It's also necessary for young learners and any student who is struggling right now. My question to you is, if you had a Patrick or a kindergartner or a student who is failing his or her classes, would you be willing to give up your income? Because that's choice A. Choice B, C, and D are hire a babysitter, enroll in private school, or your child fails. Is that a fair burden to place on our families, especially those who are struggling financially? And for those who are forced to choose option D, failure, the blame cannot come crashing down on our teachers. They have been put in an impossible situation. Decisions have been made and expectations have been set by people so far removed from the actual classroom. I can only begin to imagine the frustration our teachers must feel. As our board, it is your job to mitigate the risk of this virus and safely get our students and teachers back in the classroom where they belong. And unlike trying to be successful at remote learning, physically getting back to school is not an impossible task. We have seen it happen across the country and in our neighboring communities. And to be clear, my special education student has been offered 2 days a week, 2.5 hours each day of in-person learning. Sometimes I can hardly believe I'm fighting for just 5 hours a week. It's not nearly enough, but it's a start. I beg you, can we please finally move forward with the hybrid plan and work toward getting our students back on track and getting them the education they deserve? Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Our next speaker is Jeff B.
Hello, I'm a father of three kids who either maintain or have maintained an IEP. The virtual learning environment has been an unmitigated disaster, leading to unnecessary stress, depression, and a lack of learning that our children will pay for and lost future earnings potential. Given that the CDC Director Redfield said on November 20th, and I quote, "There's extensive data that we've gathered over the last 2 to 3 months to confirm that grades K through 12 schools can operate with face-to-face learning, and they can do it safely, and they can do it responsibly." The report went on to say that the infections we identified in schools were not acquired in schools, they were acquired in the community and the households. The CDC's data did not find a link between a rise in cases and school reopening. According to the latest numbers from the CDC, out of the approximate 328 million Americans, only 123 Americans under the age of 18 have died from the coronavirus. Overall, 99.98% recovery rate for people under the age of 50. For under 70, the recovery rate is 99.5%. Given that our children are the most important aspect of any family and represent the future of our country, and it is clear teachers can teach safely in person, when can we expect schools to follow the science and allow an option of full-time in-person learning? Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Our next speaker is Chris D.
Good evening, distinguished board members and Dr. Talley. Thank you for your time. I'm addressing you to return our students to in-person learning. The teacher's shortfall in attempts to provide students a quality remote education is not enough to overcome the dire need for in-person learning. And the board's procrastination to start implementing hybrid plans position to full daily attendance. The challenge is about this current year and less prepared than the 2019. And you're losing the 2021 class, even with the extensive changes to the curriculum, to make it more suited for remote learning. Since the beginning of the remote learning, the district has created several different education plans through surveys, opinion polls, and focus groups. As of today, my two sons have lost 1,582 class periods. 678, or 43% of these hours, cannot be replicated at home, as much as we try to provide such an environment. One class has discarded the first 5 chapters of material because it is not transferable for remote study. The amount of knowledge being taken from the children is staggering. It cannot be made up. The analysis period is over. Implement your plan. The district cannot expect to create a contingency for every possible issue. Move forward. As parents, we will be supportive,
but not when our school district leaders are paralyzed by inaction and overanalyze every random data point. The situation is no longer new, but a fact of life that will not be eradicated anytime soon. The district has made has some of the most imaginative teachers in the state performing in unbelievable circumstances, which can help ensure that the environment is safe and constructive to learning. It is time to stop procrastinating and acknowledge this new reality of periodic lockdowns, mandatory masks, and social distancing, behaviors that everyone has learned for the last 9 months. Let me close by asking, what happens to our students if the district stubbornly decides to continue this course of analysis paralysis when surrounding communities and states are backed and pursuing as the education gap gets larger? What happens to our students that are only taught to test? What happens for students no longer get scholarships because the courses are missing educational requirements like in-person labs required for accredited curricula like AP, Project Lead the Way, or trade certificates? What happens with our athletes when they no longer have seasons to be recruited? What happens to our musicians who cannot perform? Our high school students are not okay. They are showing a brave face in this adversity, but they need to return to a sense of normalcy. Thank you, and let's work together to educate our children.
Thank you, Christopher. Our next speaker is Bertha J.
Hi, greetings, board and community. Thank you for the opportunity to share my thoughts tonight. I consider myself blessed to be the mother of three Waubonsie High School graduates. Go Warriors. My youngest son graduated in 2017, but I continue to support parent and student engagement in the District 204 community. So as we face the challenges of what to do regarding students in the midst of COVID, I am sincerely concerned. Personally, I am all in for the hybrid model and hope it will be implemented in January. In my rationale regarding returning to school, I'm considering there to be an equal number of parents and students that support the hybrid model and an equal number that support the full-time in-person learning. There are many thoughts that immediately come to mind when I think of the possibility of bringing all of the students back to school. I think it would be wonderful if all of our students could be given what they have been robbed of, a safe and interactive environment full of countless personal, meaningful interactions that cannot be replicated online. Then I think of my tutoring students, and my heart is heavy because I miss them and I'm concerned about how this epidemic is truly affecting them. Then the critical questions creep up. How? How could we safely bring back all of the students? I've seen the hallways and the lunchrooms. How could all of the teachers, staff, and students possibly sit in a room for any reasonable amount of time and not risk being exposed? Lastly, the most compelling matter comes to mind. The fact that we have been facing a teacher shortage for years, way before COVID was a household name. How could any school district effectively manage the task of accommodating both sides of the coin, considering there's a limited amount of teachers? Also, do we really expect our teachers to do the impossible, teach hybrid and in person simultaneously? No way. To accomplish this dream, we would have to hire more teachers. School board members and community, I'm sure we all wish to have our students safely back in school where they belong. Yet I can think of several factors that will make our mission near impossible. The most critical of all is teacher shortage. Board members, I thank you for all your service, especially during a time like this. I truly recognize and accept all of the realities that you have to consider, such as the critical overarching definition of what is considered safe, as well as the pre-existing teacher shortage. Perhaps in the midst of all these challenges, there is an opportunity to educate the community about the extent of the current teacher shortages, and perhaps we can inspire to continue developing a robust teacher track program. Thank you.
Thank you, Bertha. Our next speaker is Eva.
Hello, my name is Eva, and I'm a proud Waubonsie parent. I have a son who is a senior in District 204, and I also had a son who's already graduated from Waubonsie Valley. My son is currently a senior. This is not the year that he had hoped it to be. However, he does not blame anyone for this. He understands the health implications of COVID-19. and that in-person learning is not currently prudent. He has been resilient and he has adapted well to e-learning. Yes, he certainly would prefer to be at school learning in person because he enjoys school. He's a great student. He enjoys his teachers and he enjoys the camaraderie of being with his friends and his classmates, as well as participating in extracurricular activities and his sports. We also recognize why the school board made the choice that was aligned with recommendations from DuPage County Health Department in regards to e-learning this semester. We understand the challenges that our district is facing. To say this has been an unprecedented year for most of us is an understatement. We are grateful for the vaccine rollout today, and we must band together with our community members by wearing masks, being socially distanced when we're outside our homes, washing our hands frequently, and avoiding large indoor gatherings. And with the vaccine, practicing the proper COVID-19 protocol in our community, we hope that we can get our students back to in-person learning soon. Last but not least, I want to thank the board president, Razak, school board member, all of the school board members, Dr. Talley, all of the district administrators, and especially our teachers for all of the hard work that you've been doing to keep our children learning during this pandemic. We know that no situation is perfect, but we just have to work together to get through all of this. Thank you.
Thank you, Eva. Our next speaker is Andrea C.
Good evening. I'm the parent of three children that have attended District 204 schools, and really I just wanted to take a minute to thank the board and Dr. Talley and the administration for everything that you're doing, for your diligence in trying to do the right thing under these extraordinary circumstances for our students, for our families, and our community. I'm sure it's quite a challenge trying to balance creating an effective learning environment for our students with meeting the emotional and mental health needs, because the pandemic has, and being at home has taken a toll on all of our mental health. So I know you're balancing learning with mental health and, most importantly, the physical health of everyone. And because we're not just talking about the students, but we're talking about the students' families, the staff and the staff's families, and ultimately our community's health. And the last thing that we want is for our schools to become a super spreading event for our community. Because while we might be able to repair and mend the mental health of our students, and we might be able to catch the students up on whatever learning they've missed are falling behind in this learning environment, we can't fix death and the pain and the harm that it may cause families in our communities. So I really appreciate your level-headed consideration of all of these things for the good of all of us, including those who wish to make reckless choices for themselves. And I just finally just want to state the obvious. Our district is not on an island, and I recognize that you're not making decisions in a vacuum. Districts all across the U.S. are facing the same circumstances, and the approach that you're taking is not dissimilar to others. So I just want to say thanks again for what you're doing. Thank you.
Thank you. We are at the 30-minute mark. In order to be fair, there was time in between each speaker. I'm going to allow two more speakers. I'm taking them in the order that they're coming. I want to be as fair as possible. The end of the second speaker, we will have to end public comment. Again, those people who weren't able, thank you, thank you, thank you for signing up for public comment. We do have a board meeting to also finish, but you can reach us at board-members@ipsd.org. Please know that we read every correspondence and again, try to acknowledge them and respond if possible. So the next two speakers, the first one is Ethan S. It appears Ethan is not here, so I will go with in the next two. Next speaker is Shanice S.
Good evening, Dr. Talley and the distinguished board. As introduced, I'm Shanice Spencer. I'm the mother of two children. My son, Trey, is a senior student athlete at Matilla Valley High School, Go Go Mustangs. He started kindergarten at Cowlishaw when Dr. Sullivan was the principal. My daughter, Kayla, is a sixth grade PA student at Hill Middle School. Dr. Talley, we were thrilled to meet you at the school district's meet and greet. We were excited about the extraordinarily impressive experience that you were bringing to our school district, which was already trailblazing and achieving excellence in so many areas. My children and many others thrive here. I can and often do rave about the many great experiences we've had at 204 schools. I can also speak about times when faculty has made things right when I had a concern. My family's experiences with 204, both past and present, including the current handling of the response to the pandemic, allows us to confidently, though not blindly, trust the superintendent, the elected school board, and faculty of 204. We support you and we're grateful for the extraordinary care and consideration you've shown when faced with making these seemingly impossible decisions concerning our children. Of course, both of my children wish to be in the school building. I share their wish. These are such pivotal academic years for both of them, and thankfully, they're both thriving academically. We've made the decision, however, that under no circumstances will they return to the school buildings for instruction this academic year. Again, my son's senior year. I respect and trust every parent's decision to do what they feel is best for their family. I also recognize that families have different circumstances. I'm able to be home full-time with my children, plus they're old enough to be self-sufficient. And I'm aware that some who are advocating for a return to school aren't doing so out of pure desire, but out of necessity, some out of fear. Many parents have to leave the house for work so that they can pay bills and put food on the table for their families, including those workers who are essential and vital. For most of us, being able to do that with confidence is predicated on what we're doing with our children during the day. It's my hope that if local and national government sees that overwhelmingly school districts are being prudent and pragmatic about returning students and teachers to the school building, it would help them to see how critically necessary it is for them to step up and provide more support to families. Similarly, employers would hopefully become more accommodating, thus allowing more families to make decisions that are truly rooted in their desires for their family and not out of fear for their family's survival, not to mention what it would do to limit transmission. So to that end, I implore you to continue to follow the science and heed the experts. We thank you, God bless you and protect you.
Thank you. Our last speaker is Versi W.
Good evening, and I would like to say thank you to the previous speaker. It's hard to kind of come behind her. She touched on all points and all bases. My name is Versi Walker. I have a son who also attends Neuqua Valley, who is a sophomore. I want to first start off by saying thank you, Dr. Talley, and the school board, as well as the teachers, for putting the physical health and well-being for all students, staff, and family as top priority in the timetable for in-person learning. As a former school board member myself from New York, I know firsthand the decisions you all have to make are not easy, especially given all that has transpired over the past 9 months. In my own household, we have a difference of opinion as it relates to this very topic. However, as you represent thousands of students, teachers, and faculties, and families. We have to trust your judgment to continue acting in the best interest of the entire community. For that, you have our support. The pandemic is a big inconvenience to us all, but we must adapt and follow the health officials' safety protocols. People are getting really sick, some dying. Others are left with lingering side effects, also now known as long haulers. We must be patient and have confidence in our school officials. Much thanks to the FDA regarding the approval of the Pfizer vaccine, I feel relieved in knowing that there is a light at the end of the tunnel. I want to thank you all. I would like for you all to have a wonderful holiday season, and God bless.
Thank you, Versi. I'm now going to move on to the agenda. Again, I'm going to remind everyone that you can contact us at board-members@ipsd.org. Again, thanks for all who signed up. It's truly, truly appreciated. We are now moving to our discussion item, and we will get an update from Dr. Talley and Mr. Acarius regarding the COVID-19 update, the reopening of schools. Dr. Talley and Mr. Acarius.
Thank you very much, Mr. Razak. Tonight during our COVID update, we will be sharing how we plan to ramp up our in-person learning starting in January. Before I turn it over to our deputy, I want to say the following. We have tried to be consistent with our use of data, metrics, and science in our decision-making practices. Our consistent practices have allowed for a steady learning paradigm rather than for a choppy practice of starting and stopping and starting and stopping. We have provided data at these meetings to keep people informed and understand what has led us to our decisions we have made. We will continue to use data to help us in our decision-making process. All of us have and continue to want to provide in-person learning for those families that want in-person learning, as well as provide remote learning for those families who want and need to keep their children home for remote learning. Our plan discussed tonight will allow for that bifurcated learning paradigm. I'll now turn it over to Mr. Acarius, our Deputy Superintendent.
Thank you, Dr. Talley and members of Board of Education. I appreciate your time this evening so we can update you on our plan for January and our return to in-person learning. Next slide, please. Many of these slides you have seen before. It's been consistent with how we've approached our return to learn. So I will go through them rather quickly so that you have plenty of time for your questions. Our goal has been to support a comprehensive educational program for the 2020-21 school year within the current guidelines provided by local, state, federal health and safety officials. Next slide, please. We started from developing a process, validating that process, monitoring and modifying, which we said would happen regularly throughout the school year. Next slide, please. Within that framework, in the middle of it was the public health and the pandemic that we've been dealing with. And we've had four different areas surrounding that, which were instructional core SEL, resources, stakeholder communication, and operations. Next slide, please. For most of this school year, we've been in phase four, revitalization. But you're probably aware that just prior to Thanksgiving, all 11 regions were moved into phase three. However, at that time, the state did say that school districts should work with their local health departments on how to address what to do for schools during that time. Next slide, please. So as you know, right before our Thanksgiving break, we did pause that transition to hybrid. We did this as the state of Illinois implemented tier three mitigation across all 11 regions. We also, at that time, DuPage County Health Department had reported substantial community transmission for 6 consecutive weeks. During that same time period, we saw significant increases in case counts per 100,000. DuPage increased during that time from 79 to 543 cases per 100,000, and Will County increased from 87 to 743. During that time, we also faced increased shortages in teaching, nursing, and support staff available to support in-person learning due to isolations and quarantines. We do have 586 active substitutes. Our challenge at that time was not related to the amount of substitutes that we had available. We saw at that time, for instance, our nursing staffing was down 20% at that time. We had teaching teams of teachers, which caused very difficult situations for us where we only had 4 support staff left on certain teams without any licensed staff available for some of our students who have some very significant needs. And then we also experienced where entire offices, main offices at schools, where we had to isolate and quarantine the entire staffs at those offices, in which we were trying to fill in and cover at those offices to try to maintain as much as we could. Next slide, please. So you've seen this slide. It's about the DuPage County COVID-19 school metrics. The area that we've been in most recently has been substantial community transmission, which encourages 100% remote learning. However, as we've communicated, school officials should use their discretion and expertise to determine which populations of students should receive in-person instruction, whose needs are less likely to be met by virtual instruction. Even when DuPage first went to substantial, we did try to continue with in-person learning for groups of our students until it became extremely difficult to maintain. Next slide, please. These metrics are the metrics that just came out today. They were, I know, updated after 3 o'clock today. On our last metrics that came from DuPage County, which was last Monday, we saw actually the 4 arrows in the middle there actually pointing the other way and in blue. And this week they're pointing up, which means they're showing an increase from the previous week. So when you see new cases per 100,000 per week in the previous update we had, which was for 1128, I know that was down in the 400s and now it's at 581. That's why that's showing that that's an increase at this time. You'll see the increased percentage for weekly case count trend, weekly youth case count trend, and weekly test positivity went from 11.7 to 12.5%. That's why you would see that those arrows are pointing up, because of how they, what that those metrics did compared to the previous week. Next slide, please. This just shows a trend over time. As I talked about the 11 regions that are in phase 3, these are actually showing our region positivity rates. So you'll see region 8, which is DuPage and Kane County. Back when we tried to start bringing students in, you'll see that's when those positivity cases started to really spike, where you see for region 8, where it was 10.6, 15.8. Most recently on December 10th, down to 12.7. We're glad that it's going in the right direction. And you'll see Will County, which serves about 45% of our district students live in Will County. You'll see that that was even a bit higher, where it went from 8.2 to 11.4 to 19.8%, and now that's down to 13.5% as of the 10th. And you'll also see where our state overall, what those percentages look like. Next slide, please. We did want to show it just by our 2 counties instead of including in the regions. You'll see it includes 2 counties, and you can kind of see what those positivity rates are doing within those counties. Most recently, Will County was at 14.9% on the 10th, and for DuPage County at 11.7%. Definitely going in a better direction than where we were at just before Thanksgiving. We just wanted to briefly show once again what the metrics are, also the indicators from CDC. I know Dr. Talley had shared these in the last metrics, where those numbers lie. So we are still wanting to see those numbers get better. For the percentage of positive, the positivity rate over the last 14 days, we are trickling, starting to get under 10% again, which is a good sign. I think most recently it spiked just back to 10.17%, but it had been under 10% for a little while as well. And hopefully those cases per 100,000 can go back down in the other direction. So with that, we fully understand that, we want students in person. I think everybody wants students in person, and we know that we need to do that safely. We also know that remote doesn't work for everybody. And so the next slide, please, shows us what our plan was. We did say that students would be on remote through the 15th. We talked about that to build in that natural quarantine period after winter break so that we can come back full and ready to go. So that week of January 18th, please remember 18th, there is no school on the 18th, so that would actually start on the 19th. We do plan for that week to bring in early childhood, kindergarten through second grade, and our pilot classes that we're going in October. We're planning on bringing self-contained students back in, STEP students back in, our Wheatland Academy students, and then students who need some additional supports at middle school and high school. The reason that we're doing that on the week of the 18th for middle school and high school, it is the last week of the semester. So high school will have finals that week. We did not want to bring them in for a completely different process just for finals that week. And middle school, it is the last week of the both either quarter or semester. And so to have students adjust for the final week of a quarter and then start a new pattern the next week, we thought it would be better to start at the beginning of the semester. So that following week, the week of January 25th, is when we would bring in the rest of our elementary students, grades 3 through 5. We would start by bringing in grade 6, who have not been in our middle schools yet. I know Mr. Hillman will talk a little bit more about that when we talk about the middle school schedule. And we will be bringing in high school the week of the 25th. And then the following week, we'll bring in the rest of our middle schoolers at grades 7 and 8. Next slide, please. We do know there are certain realities when we do transition to in-person learning. Teachers will have to plan for in-person and remote students for each day. We commend our teachers for all of their hard work and what they continue to do in trying to meet the needs of all of our learners. We know that some remote learners may have less live time compared to what they might currently have. For most students, in-person is 2 days each week. There are some students that we're bringing in more than that, but for most students, in-person is 2 days each week. A reality is there is an increased possibility of COVID transmission in our schools. Middle school and high school teachers may have to Zoom and teach in-person at the same time. What that would look like is we would expect that you might see your teacher conducting a lesson in front of their class where the other students are Zooming in to watch that lesson. We do know that quarantined and isolated teachers may have to Zoom into the classroom from home. We have seen that other school districts, this is how they've approached that, where there is another adult who's in the classroom with the students, monitoring the students in the classroom or answering questions for students while the teacher is teaching from home if they're quarantined or isolated. And we know that teachers who are not returning to the building may have to Zoom into the classroom from home. Once again, there are staffing challenges. And those are some ways that we're going to have to support the entire system. With that, Laura Rosenblum, our assistant superintendent for elementary schools, is gonna continue with the next slide.
Good evening. It's my pleasure to review with you our preschool schedule and our elementary schedule for our return to in-person learning. For early childhood, we're very fortunate that we were able to implement our in-person model before Thanksgiving. All of our preschool students that selected in person were in fact already able to attend school. Due to the hard work of our early childhood staff and our partnerships with families, we found success for students and staff. The safety protocols and schedules put in place were carefully followed. For our return to learn, we will continue with this same schedule. Students will come 2 half days per week, either Tuesday and Thursday mornings or Tuesday and Thursday afternoons, or Wednesday and Friday mornings or Wednesday and Friday afternoons. The session assigned will continue to be based on the total number of students that select in person. In-person students will also be provided with learning packets and supports for home. Students who are fully remote will continue to have learning packets, weekly connections with staff, and now they also have the ability to access instruction via technology. Next slide, please. Our elementary pilot classrooms have already given us an opportunity to be in person and provided us feedback to continue to improve our program. We are ready to bring back more students. Our elementary students who select in-person learning will attend 2 mornings per week. They will either attend Tuesdays and Thursdays or Wednesdays and Fridays from 9 to 11:30. The afternoon session from 12:30 to 3:30 will be live virtual instruction for our students who are all remote and our in-person students who were not in session in the morning. On Mondays, all students will continue with the current schedule. With our half-day plan, we are able to ensure that all students get 2.5 hours of live instruction with their teacher. This was very important to our teachers because they wanted to be sure they saw all of their students every day, which is one of the reasons we're not doing a full day model. The other reason is that our teachers have found when being on Zoom leading instruction, it takes their full attention and concentration to meet the needs of students on Zoom. They felt that live streaming for our youngest learners would diminish the students' engagement level. Our intermediate grade teachers see that their students might be ready for live streaming on a limited basis, like for math, so we will continue to explore ways to engage students at the highest levels. Next slide, please. The biggest concern for parents and teachers alike is the amount of independent time for our elementary students. We have continued to work hard to plan a structure and to provide guidance that will support our students during this time. Teachers are working to connect the assignments and opportunities for practice to the work they will do during live instruction. Meeting with students every day makes this more possible. Staff are also mindful of the amount of screen time and are working to provide assignments that can be done independent of the screen. While we do have many wonderful digital learning resources like Zurn and Lexia that students will use for part of their independent time, because these digital resources differentiate practice and collect data to help us better meet student needs. Teachers have worked to strategically use these programs to support student learning. Teachers also want to work to be meaningful and the directions clear and easy to follow. They've been working on video directions, lessons on Google Classroom updates, and other ways to support students. Again, our pilot teachers have really led the way and provided some great guidance for us in terms of how we can be most effective in this work. Additionally, students may be participating in small group instruction outside of their AM and PM times. Our teachers truly are amazing. Their hard work, creativity, and responsiveness have made remote learning effective and will make our hybrid model a success too. Next slide, please. To help illustrate a little better what a day may look like for a student, here is a sample. Remember, this is just not a sample, not the exact schedule for each grade level at your school. The reason it'll look different at different grade levels in different schools is because we continue to stagger the time for guided enrichment and intervention. We stagger specials time and math blocks. A few things to note, if you follow the blue, that's when there's live instruction occurring in the AM in person and in the PM on Zoom. You can see that the time allocations mirror or repeat the AM and PM schedule for the live learning, as does the white columns for the independent times. You can see that even during independent times, there are opportunities for additional live instruction. Students will also continue to have specials together as a class. For us to make the best plans, an accurate account of how many students will be all remote and how many will be all in person is essential. We will honor the selection you made for the second quarter unless you would like to change it. If you're keeping your selection the same, you don't need to do anything at all. If you would like to change your selection, please call your school's office by Wednesday at noon and let them know your new selection. Those numbers make it possible for us to determine the rest of our schedule. Thank you for your time today. And at this point, I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Hillman, who will review the middle and high school schedules.
Good evening, members of the board. Dr. Kelly, how are you today? The middle school schedule is the same schedule that we have presented to you at the October 19th board meeting. This middle school schedule does have a similar theme to the schedule that is currently being utilized by students. Right now, we are using Monday as an all virtual time, and that will continue on in the new schedule, in which students will be engaging with their teachers in remote learning throughout the entire day and being able to get a preview from their teachers for the upcoming week. Then when we transition, we'll be having an A day on Tuesday and Wednesday, in which one set of students will be coming into the building on that same day, both days, and they will be experiencing their full schedule between Tuesday and Wednesday. Periods one and five will be through one through five will be covered on Tuesday, with periods six through the advisory period covered on Wednesday. And then our B students will be coming in on Thursday and Friday and going through their entire schedule as well, just through Thursday and Friday. And then we have independent learning structured or set up from two until three on all 4 days. In this particular schedule, you will notice that a particular student, when they are in the building over the course of 2 days, will get through their entire schedule one time. And I point that out to you because that was one of the deciding factors on bringing in our sixth graders independent of the seventh and eighth graders. So that way they would have time in the building independent of having others in the building to be able to maneuver in the building. One of the other parts to that particular decision is that in the spring, we generally have many orientation sessions in which we bring our fifth grade students into the middle school. We have tours, we have activities to set for them to get to know the building, to understand where the office is, key pieces for people who can help them, and also just to kind of become less overwhelmed with being at the middle school. Additionally, during the summertime, we have other orientation sessions where we have students come in and participate as well in those orientation sessions to, again, feel comfortable, know the building, and be able to feel like they can successfully navigate it. Even though we will have significantly smaller numbers of students in the building during that first week, we will be having some other structures that we've never had to talk about before, such as directions that students must follow when they are walking throughout the building and how to successfully navigate it with some of the COVID protocols. So that was one, that's kind of the rationale behind starting sixth grade independent of the seventh and eighth graders. And we did that during the second week simply because all of our students will be finishing up their second or first semester classes before transitioning into second semester classes in their encore class. So continuing on with the middle school schedule, if we could move to the next slide. A couple of the things that we do want to point out is that on days when students are not going to be in class, they are going to be engaging with their teachers. They're going to be engaging in a remote setting, and their teachers will be doing a couple of different things. Sometimes their teachers will be working with both the students who are there and the students who are at home, the roomers and the zoomers, to be able to engage both sets at the same time. Other points in time during a lesson, a teacher could be giving the students who are at home independent work time and focusing their time primarily on the students who are sitting in front of them. And then they could potentially switch that very setup up and begin focusing on the students who are at home and asking the students who are in person to be working independently. So there is going to be some asynchronous and synchronous time throughout every period for all students, I would imagine. And that could shift by day, depending upon the instructional task that is taking place on that particular day. So the other part is that students who are in remote learning and are not going to be in our buildings, we are doing our best to make sure that the experience that they have is close as we can to the experience that our students who are going to be in our buildings during the hybrid session. So it will require some work on the teacher's part to be able to think about how is it that we are going to make those experiences somewhat equal to the best of our ability for those students who are not going to be in session with us. We are going to work on staggering our transitions so that way we do not have the entire building transitioning at once. We are able to do that at the middle school level because of the teaming process that we have. But there are a couple of times when we are going to have to work very diligently because it is almost impossible when we are shifting between core and encore, not to have all of our students in the hallways at one time, simply because the room that they are going to be going to is going to be utilized by another group of students who need to leave it for them to come in. So we will be working on that. And buildings have been working with their teams of teachers to come up with how to do that because each schedule in each building has its own unique circumstances. And then finally, we will be reducing the dependence on shared equipment. And we do have procedures in place to reduce that. And then when shared equipment is going to be needed, how to be able to best clean that and make sure that the equipment is ready for the next group of students. Moving into the high school schedule. Previously, you have heard from Linda Rakestra and the three high school principals concerning their schedule. Linda did a wonderful job in assisting the staff at the high schools to be able to incorporate parent and community input into coming up with this schedule. This is the same schedule that you heard on the November 2nd board meeting with no changes to it. You're looking at a very similar set schedule to the middle school in the standpoint that Monday is going to be all remote, and then we are bringing in groups of students on the Tuesday, Wednesday, or the Thursday, Friday, and then they experience pieces of their schedule on each day that they are in. And then they have academic support time identified very similar to the middle school model in the second half of the day. And again, they're using lunch to be able to travel students, and that lunchtime is elongated for both travel and lunch. On the next slide, you will notice a couple of pieces that are very similar. One of the parts that the high school is going to be working with very diligently is to ensure that the asynchronous time does have enough time to focus on student homework because they are hearing that there is some struggles to be able to complete all of the activities that are required for high school homework after the session. And so they are going to be building in when students are in session some work time to be able to make that possible for students to be as successful in their work completion as they can. Their schedule, again, is very similar with the rooming and Zooming. We're going to be dependent upon that at both the middle school and the high school level in order for our students to be successful and to stay engaged. One of the pieces that is a little different is that the high school is going to have a much more difficult time with the student transitions. While they are going to work on staggering them, when they can, the realities of not being on teams and having students mix between so many different classes really makes that process very challenging. So we just want to be upfront about that. The other part that some people have been asking about is that we have left all of the periods in both the middle school and high school schedule And all of those periods include student lunch that is being identified. So what are students going to be doing during lunchtime? So if their lunch is fourth period. At the high school, because the students are older, they are going to have the option to be able to come in late if their lunch is first period, or potentially leave early if their lunch is last period. So we have worked through that. But those students who are remaining, we will have spaces throughout the building where we will be able to have them social distance and be able to get assistance from staff members should they need it, and to be able to get work done. So that way, hopefully, again, while they're there, their time is as useful as possible. And that concludes the high school piece. I will pass it back to Mr. Icarius to go over the steps schedule.
Our steps will be resuming their opportunities. The step students will be in attendance 1, 2, 3, or 4 days per week based on the student's steps pathway. When students are not in person, remote learning will continue. I know Dr. Sepiel and Ms. Maloney have been working hard on job opportunity, increasing those job opportunities in January for students. 100% of STEP students will be using the Teach Town program. The transition to adulthood program uses point of view video modeling, task analysis, computer-based lessons, teacher-delivered lessons, and visual supports to teach a range of critical functional skills. And Fridays will be a remote learning day for the STEPS program, consisting of IEP goal work, SEL activities, and elective Friday. Next slide, please. Throughout in-person learning, we will maintain a focus on our safety protocols, cleaning and disinfecting, physical distancing, where students and teachers must adhere to 6 feet of social distancing, symptom checks, personal protective equipment, ensuring that we have PPE available for those who need it. Next slide, please. Our transportation, when provided, will consist of physical distancing. Same household students seated together, face mask required. Building use, we still have no building rentals except Park District and YMCA. We will have an isolation room in the building as well as an extra room. Isolation rooms are the location for students exhibiting symptoms at school, and parents must pick them up as soon as possible. Home isolation is for students and staff that test positive for COVID-19, and then home quarantine is when students and staff come in close contact. Once again, if they're in close contact, less than 6 feet for a cumulative 15 minutes, then they would be quarantined if they were in close contact of someone who did test positive for COVID-19. Next slide, please. Once again, please, if you are experiencing any of the known symptoms, diarrhea, abdominal pain, congestion, runny nose, loss of sense of taste, the smell, nausea, fatigue, muscle or body aches, fever above 100.4 degrees, headache, shortness of breath, cough, sore throat, or vomiting, you should stay home. We will have some exclusionary measures. Anybody who's symptomatic, stay home at least 10 days from the onset of symptoms and improvement of symptoms, unless there's an alternative diagnosis or negative COVID-19 test. And at that time, household members should be quarantined as well. If you've been exposed to COVID-19, once again, if you've been within someone who tests positive, you've been within 6 feet for at least 15 minutes. You should stay home for 14 days after the last exposure to COVID-19 case. Close contact should also as well. Those who are in the household, or as I said, those within 6 feet for 15 minutes. Positive or probable COVID-19, it's 10-day isolation from the onset of symptoms. Please return only after symptoms have improved. All close contacts and household quarantine should be quarantined for 14 days from that last contact. Throughout this, we try to stay focused on our portrait of a graduate, social-emotional learning, and our equity, diversion, and inclusion. And so with that, on our final slide is questions from the Board of Education.
Thank you, staff, for the presentation. As in the past, I will ask each board member to take a turn and ask the questions. I will begin with Mrs. Grover.
Thank you for the presentation. I just have a couple of questions and then a comment. You had mentioned about parents making the decision, the parents need to make a decision. I think there's some confusion whether it is for the semester or the quarter. Are they choosing for the semester, if you can kind of clarify that?
Right now, we're asking them to choose it for next semester. But we know, I mean, we're going to constantly modify and see what we can do if there's other opportunities. But we are asking people to try to make a choice for the semester.
I know one of the concerns is students that their achievement is, they're not doing too well. What are we doing for those students? If you can elaborate on that.
Part of, well, we're actually working quite a bit with, at all the different levels. We have another meeting on this Wednesday with our middle school leadership team. We have just been working with our high school leadership team to talk about the students who, I'm assuming you're referring to the students who with the D's and F's.
Yes.
And different supports we can put in place. Those are also the students that we identified that week of the 19th that we would like to start seeing if we can get those students to come in person. We've got a lot of different interventions that we're trying with those students. Some of them are trying to set up some online tutoring sessions, trying to invite them for even one-on-one sessions or small group sessions outside of their regular school day, trying to reach out to their families to talk about how we can engage those students. But we will be looking at what are those other opportunities when we, if those students do come in person, you know, can we keep them longer for the day? Can they stay for lunch? Can they stay for academic period in the afternoon? What are those opportunities that we're going to have for the students? Some of those students who are struggling might choose not to come for in-person learning. So we're going to probably most likely have individual conversations with those families to see if it's out of if it's for health reasons and what can we do to help them feel safer to come in person. So we're working hard right now on figuring out all different ways that we can reach out to them. We're also looking what else might we need to do over the summer to support some of that learning. Obviously, that might be a little bit more difficult for our seniors and trying to figure that out. But we have everything on the table right now to see what we can do to support those students.
Okay, thanks. My last question is, there was some concern with teachers on how they would do the Zooming and rooming. And I know Mr. Hillman had talked about the asynchronous and synchronous. We had some pilots and I know the administration had gone to see other districts doing that. What have we learned with doing the how the teachers are able to do both remote and teach in class?
You know, we did try it on small scale. I mean, there's definitely challenges. It's new. Our teachers do, you know, as you know, they often rise to the occasion. But there are different things that are going to happen with that. Reminding, you know, yourself after maybe you're teaching a lesson and trying to then shift over and remembering to ask the students on screen also what kind of questions they have on that, or devoting some, you know, telling the students in class, okay, now you're going to work independently on this so I can focus on the students who might be at home trying to learn. Some teachers are doing different setups where they might have on the screen in front of them all the students that are home on the big screen so they can students in class see those students at home as well. We know that we want to make sure that, you know, the sound and communication works well for both. We also might see if we have available adults, you know, there might be co-teaching situations where one adult might be able to monitor what's going on with the students on Zoom while the other one are focusing on the students in person. But it's going to be an adjustment. It's going to be challenging work. It's going to be new. And, you know, there's, you know, I think we're going to need some grace in you know, as we try to instruct in that new format.
Thank you. Thank you. I just have a statement I'd like to read. We received emails from the community, and I want you to know that we hear you. To those parents who want their kids in school, we hear you. We already were bringing in kids who needed intervention, pre-K students, special need kids, and had started a pilot where we brought in the elementary school kids. We heard you regarding the high school schedule and therefore implemented a plan where we would bring in high schoolers 2 days a week instead of once a month. To those parents who are choosing remote and are worried about their students will not have the same rigor as those in school, we hear you too. Therefore, we implemented rooming and Zooming and made sure that courses offered at the high school level, like APs, were available regardless of whether you chose in person or at home. To the teachers and staff, we hear you. You are the ones guiding our students. We want to ensure your safety and have taken safety measures. We understand that we are asking you a lot to juggle rooming and Zooming. We recognize the impact that remote learning has had on students' SEL and academics. Therefore, we have specifically set aside time in the schedule for SEL, and we are doing our interventions to help those that have academic need. Is this perfect? No. There is always room for improvement, and therefore we continue to listen, monitor, and modify. Several of us on the board have children in the district. I realize that remote learning is not for everyone. Parents should have a choice whether their child should be learning in person or remote. We have seen that with all the precautions, school is a safe place, and I'm looking forward to having the students safely return in January. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Grover. Ms. Donahue.
Okay, I have a few questions also. So, what is the plan for bringing the teachers back into the buildings?
Ms. Donahue, the plan is that the week of January 4th, teachers are encouraged to be back in the buildings. The week of January 11th, teachers are required to be back in 2 days a week. And then the week of the 18th, starting really on the 19th, teachers will be back in the buildings 4 days a week.
Okay. We're confronted with an evolving and wide variety of data sources to use in our decision-making. We have relied on DuPage metrics and Illinois Department of Health guidance and CDC guidance. Are we considering any other metrics right now?
Yes, Ms. Donahue, we are. Northwestern University has data out there that we are looking at to look more closely at what's happening within the district itself. And so we continue to look at what other data sources. And we are also looking at data from within Indian Prairie to include such things as how many cases of COVID are happening within our schools. We're looking at the number of resources we have, meaning such as PPE that we have available and for how long will it last us, staff availability to be in classrooms and cover offices. So we're looking at a wide variety of data sources.
Right, because we haven't had any transmission in our schools, and there is a lot of data out there that says schools are not super spreader environments. So my last question, then I have a statement also, is are we investigating plans for additional school hours? So let's assume everything goes well and we have everybody sign up and we have understanding of how many kids are going to be in the different schools. Are we looking at additional possible school hours for these kids and also possibly enhancing or broadening our summer program to offer more educational opportunities in the summer?
We're always looking at different things that we can offer. As said in the very beginning of the presentation, we're always monitoring and modifying. And so we are always having these conversations. Our cabinet, we meet three times a week talking about how can we enhance, how can we improve? And so we are not, what we're presenting is not finalized, it never is, because we're looking at ways in which to make learning available for more times as whenever we can.
Okay. All right, so I'm gonna read my statement. So despite the incredible work of our teachers and staff, we know that remote learning does not work for some students. I empathize with the parents who want in-person learning. I also want to see students in school. After the state mandated our lockdown in the spring and facing the possibility we would have to support remote learning in the fall, our staff prepared all summer by taking professional training to increase our skills in remote learning and social emotional learning. When a much higher percentage as compared to our survey selected the remote option, we had to make a difficult decision to pivot our plans and start with a robust remote program that included the vast majority of our high school classes versus our original thoughts on offering only a subset. With strong remote experience, we would be prepared for future situations where we might have to convert a class, a school, or hopefully we won't have to do this, but convert our district back to a remote. Our actions to bring in struggling students, our special needs students, and our pre-K students in October until our pause on November 23rd were important steps for some of our most vulnerable students. I welcomed the pilots in 9 schools to refine safety protocols, practice room and Zoom, and be thoroughly prepared for our remote volume of families who desire to be in the in-person option. We provided professional development, ran pilots, put in place safety measures, obtained PPE, practiced transportation, and lined up a pool of around 700 substitute resources. We have a plan that will safely put our students and staff in our buildings. We are ready. We will continue to use evidence-based metrics to help guide our decision-making. Our community needs to take all the identified actions to control community transmission, to protect our educational settings. I look forward to seeing the students in school in January, and we are all in this together.
Thank you, Ms. Donahue. Mr. Rising.
I don't have any questions. Just going to read what I wanted to say. So how did we get here? April 2020, dozens, if not hundreds of staff members and administrators start to develop the plans for the 2021 school year. June 15th, the board of the administration discussed things and learned how to improve based on what we learned from remote learning in the spring and how to make changes come the fall. June 28th, Illinois State Board of Education releases their guidelines on how schools should be open in 2021. A mere 2 weeks later, we discussed as a district our first release of our framework to plan to return to school. Committee work and factors around safe return to school for all the areas of the district, how the scheduling of the students would work and what our challenges are and where we can succeed in bringing the students back. That was 2 weeks after the Illinois State Board of Education guidelines. Planning since April 2020, all the way to July 13th. Now fast forward from July 13th, we've had 10 meetings, 10, in which the board and administration have discussed plans and returning to school. Every single one of those meetings, we discussed the plans. We have aligned to the framework we put in place since July 13th. Why are we at where we are? We said it would be fluid. We had a delay. We delayed till the end of the first quarter. And because the metrics went up so much, we had to put it on pause until after winter break. What I'm frustrated about is the people questioning the hard work of the superintendent, the administration, who have been with this district, some of them for their whole careers, principals, teachers who have tirelessly worked, and some of which have been there with us for their careers, and staff. I'm frustrated that people have said there is no hard work that have gone into this. It might not be what you want. We may not be where you want, but everyone has been busting their butts on this. To the parents, I thank you. I understand. And all those people I previously mentioned, they know the hard work you have been doing as parents and the hard discussions you're having with your children regarding online school, if they should be in school, their grades, how they are doing socially, emotionally. It is truly what motivates all of us is your students and you. Above everyone, I want to thank our students. And I personally want to apologize. I know this is not the year that you wanted or you deserved. As for the board, superintendent, administration, principals, teachers, and staff, there is nothing we care about other than our own families, are the students of our district. For the last 10 years, personally, other than my family, I have put my volunteer, no pay, thankless, elected job and role of school board member, of which I cherish with all my heart, above everything else in my life. I do so because I love our community. I love our school district. I love our kids. And I know I can speak for all my fellow board members because I've watched for many years the dedication and the commitment they've given to this district. Here's a situation 204 in every public school district is in. We have a governor that says we can go back to school and the school districts can make their own decision. We have a state board of education that says align with the Illinois Department of Public Health and also follow your local medical experts. That's the DuPage County Health Department. The board and the superintendent have read thousands and thousands of emails and correspondence. We have read every single one, and I can tell you every single one because I remember them. The board and the superintendent read tens of thousands of articles and emails and articles on from the CDC, American Academy of Pediatrics, OSHA, AMA, American Association of Psychologists, information from the governor, IDPH, ISBE, and local health. We've also seen every plan by every district that is out there. And our administration has looked at every plan and what and we've created what works best for 204. Not what works for other districts, what works for 204 based on the benefits and the challenges we have as a district. So here's where this gets interesting. None of this is right or wrong. Everyone has a different opinion. We have a split community. And everyone will rationalize what their argument is and what their stance is if they want online or if they want in person. Above everything else, the school district does its best for students and their safety of everyone, including the staff, everyone. It is not my place to tell you what is safe for you or your family, but it is my responsibility to ensure the safety as best I can and voice my opinion as one board member. So I reached out to superintendents and administrators who have had students back that I know in DuPage County, Will County, Kane County, Cook County. I talked to them all about their decision-making process and how they decided to go back to school. I've also learned of all the other county health departments, DuPage is extremely rigid in their language about schools compared to other counties. I've learned that in all those other school districts, there has been no spread of COVID inside of their schools. I reached out to the DuPage Regional Office of Education and talked to our regional officer, Darlene Ricchetti, about the thousands of kids that have been in school since the beginning or late end of August. There's been no transmission of COVID in schools. All the COVID cases from staff or students have been contracted outside of the school. In many cases, these school districts, I've learned the number of staff that tested positive, the frequency of positivity actually went down when students were back in the buildings. Now, I'm no medical expert, but here's the lessons I've learned. Safety protocols work. Parents, students, and staff can be trusted to follow the rules in our schools. I've heard this from all the superintendents who have kids and staff in the building. Masks and social distancing works. Masks and social distancing not only work in our schools, it is the direction we've been given by our state to mitigate the spread of COVID in our community. Again, masks and social distancing work at the district level, the state, and in our country. So while we're all doing the best with online learning, especially our teachers and students, it's time we prioritize the teachers and students getting into school. Yes, as a board member, I've given the guidance to follow the health department. But here's the problem. There's even conflicting information there, even from the experts. There's conflicting information from our president-elect, the CDC, Fauci, the governor, Illinois, IDPH. there's even conflicting information within our state on numbers. Everyone will be able to rationalize the data and their opinions all day long, but I need to make a decision what's best for everybody personally as one school board member. So what do I have to base my decision on? It's quite simple. Masks and social distancing work. There has been no transmission of COVID where safety protocols were strictly enforced, not in DuPage, not in Illinois, not in the United States. This is what I always keep coming back to. Masks and social distancing work. Our only focus should be not losing our children academically or socially, emotionally. We've tried our best. We've gotten those SPED students back, the academically struggling kids back, but we need to do better, and we can't continue on this roller coaster of getting kids back or not getting kids back. We also cannot go back and forth and pause again like Dr. Talley referred to. Yes, it's true. Some students are doing wonderful with online learning, and I will always advocate for those students and those families that they continue to receive an excellent education. However, we've lost too many of our students already academically and socially, emotionally. We need to stop bleeding and hemorrhaging of those kids. We need to get back because we trust our community and we trust that masks and social distancing work. We need to get the kids back. This isn't for everyone, and I'm not advocating it should be, but we need to stop the viciousness in our community and the divisiveness. We're better than that as a community. There was talk about how it could become a long, dark winter with COVID. Yes, I'm still worried about that. I'm concerned for myself, my family, and I take precautions. However, what I'm equally concerned about is a long, dark winter we'll see not only in our children's academics, but the long, dark winter we'll see in our children's mental health, in which they may never recover. I wish the community a wonderful holiday season for health and safety, and I look forward to our children being back learning and our teachers safely teaching our students online and in person in January. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you, Mr. Rising. Ms. Deming.
Thank you, President Razak. I did have a question regarding just if we could share the sanitization of our schools when our students are in during the day. I would appreciate a little more explanation on that, please.
Ms. Deming, I assume you're talking about how we clean the schools.
Exactly that protocol, yes, Dr. Talley.
Yes. So with the cleaning, every evening we make a focus on all of our high touch areas. So we use approved disinfecting, which we use on desks, door handles, you know, in the restroom area. You know, where we'll have our custodial staff that focus on that. We do have in every classroom and throughout the buildings, we do have appropriate disinfectant and rags and gloves to be able to wipe down tables and desks. But we will not have the custodial force to do that in between classes at our middle schools and at our high schools for each time they change classes. So it will be there available for people to be able to wipe down those desks themselves, but it will not be done by the custodians.
You know, one of the challenges certainly that that our students have, some of our students have faced social and emotional challenges, and I think we all recognize that. For those, and we certainly have heard from people who've looked for outside resources, and certainly our IEP students, you know, have resources that they can take advantage of, although some have had difficulties with the remoteness. But are we able to turn to any additional sources, whether it's 360, to help support students that we see have emotional, social needs that may not, their family may not have the resources to turn to an outside entity? Can you share anything that we're able to provide in that area?
I know we do have a close connection with them, and I in which we try to work closely with them to support students and to be able to offer some of those services. I would have to get a little bit more information specifically from our building about when they're turning to them or how that is going. I'm assuming from your question about, you know, are you talking about for 360 to do any type of home visits or stuff like that, or?
No, I wasn't talking home visits, just whether, whether it's home, not necessarily home, but even if it's, you know, virtual, but any resources that families need to turn to if they don't have those outside resources, are we able to direct them or provide any type of assistance recommendations?
Yeah, so our counselors, our social workers, our mental health therapists that are in the buildings are able to, one, connect with the families, but then two, they can make recommendations to outside sources to support families as well. We know that this is an important aspect of what we have to do. And so when we aren't able to support them ourselves, we can do those recommendations to other resources in the neighborhood.
Thank you. And I will, I have a statement. I first want to thank Dr. Talley during this tumultuous and challenging period we've all faced in this 9-month session, six of those with you at our helm, Dr. Talley. Your commitment and concern for our students and staff has been evident from your official introduction to our district in January to the deliberative and consultative decisions you've made over the last few months. Your collaboration with your co-DuPage superintendents, the DuPage Health Department, and your team has resulted in decisions that have not been easy, but as I have worked with you, I have never doubted you being guided by the utmost concern for our district community. To our administrators and staff, you have and continue to pivot and adapt to new ways to use educational resources, bring much creativity to our students as possible. Your tireless efforts have not gone unnoticed, and we thank each and every one of you for caring about every single scholar you face each new school day. And parents and students, I thank you for the innumerable passionate emails that you have written the board advocating for the desired plan you wish implemented for school attendance. Without question, I and every single one of my co-board members desires to have our students back in our school buildings, learning from their teachers in a face-to-face environment, engaging with friends and participating in after-school activities, whether it's elementary school robotics, middle school chorus, or high school athletics. We want them back. Your communication has been extremely important as we have struggled with making the decisions required during this time. While we have received correspondence supporting our platform, as well, we've received communication indicating a different desired path. All of your thoughts have been appreciated. Whether you agree or not, it is vital for you to know that every decision we have made and will continue to make is done with the safety and concern utmost for all of our students, staff, and community. I take my role as a school board member seriously and do want our students back in school as quickly and safely as possible. Safety for our staff and students will always be the driving motivating factor for each and every decision I make as a member of this esteemed body. Transmission of COVID is not occurring in our schools. I hope we each will do our part to mitigate health concerns, and I was reminded of this by Nurse Carol Williams from Aurora's Rush Copley. Mayor Irving read a plea from her for her community residents at a November council meeting of just a few weeks ago. It went viral. Please take the time to read it. Her plea, I hope, will remind all of us what we can do to ensure our children and entire community can ultimately move successfully toward increased engagement both inside and outside of our school buildings. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Bemmy. With that, Ms. Peel.
Thank you, Mr. Razak. I was wondering if Doug, if you would go to, I think it's slide 3, presentation. one with the public health. Yeah, that one. Back to the public health. We've seen this presentation so many times now. It starts, you don't pay attention to those first few slides, but today I was like, look at, this has been our focus the whole entire time, and that public health is the centerpiece and we ignore it. Everybody is tired of the pandemic. Everybody wants to move on, and we all understand that. And I've reflected on some of the emails when we get them in. I feel like I'm reading an email that I myself may have written. I know when we were looking at the boundaries for the high school, I wrote the board, my opinion of what I thought was a better way to figure out boundaries for a high school. I don't know if they listen to me or what, but it always feels good to voice your opinion. And I do think the board has always paid attention. But we are still in a pandemic, and that is the center of what's going on in this district right now. And I appreciate that our focus is on the welfare of our students and our families and our teachers and our community. I do want to point out too that we talk about the mitigation efforts to keep everybody safe. And one of them is the quarantine that requires nearly 14 days of being not at work. And we talk about how that affects not only our school staffing ability, but it also affects those folks that are working. And correct me if I got this wrong, but I thought I understood the CARES program would only allow for somebody to have a leave of absence one time only. After that, they're using their sick days or whatever. And this is only if they're exposed and don't even, they haven't tested positive. It's on them to get tested. And I guess my point is, these are mitigation efforts that we have had to use when other school districts have had the opportunity, maybe because their budget can afford it, to provide testing. U of I, that's the way they made it work on the campus, is by testing the students. I think it's twice a week. We don't have that luxury in this district right now. And I think people need to be aware when we're comparing other districts, we look different. I'm really glad the board members earlier kind of pointed out the difference in our budgets this earlier in the evening. But when I look back on 15, 16 years ago, when I was writing the board, we were looking at boundaries for Third High School, and we decided, and there was a decision made, and there were many folks that were still not happy about it. But what happened afterwards was people started to realize that their students were thriving in this district nonetheless. It didn't matter which high school their kids were going to. It's difficult to go through a pandemic as a leader of a school, especially right now when people are so tired of the pandemic. But boundaries are difficult too. And I'm sure they had probably just as many emails at that point. I know when I was on the board and we talked about a budget cuts of over $10 million, we were getting emails about everybody's favorite program that was going to be affected, including the music program. We increased the student to teacher ratio rather than reducing that. But I believe this board, just like the boards of that handled those situations have always been student focused, because that's what it's going to take to get us through this period, is to stay student focused. And you can't be student focused without also being teacher focused, without also being family focused. That is the only way we can be student focused. We know that we have friends and family that are being terribly affected by this pandemic. And that public health part is to prevent that tragic. I think one of our earlier speakers spoke to, a death is absolutely tragic and there's no turning that back. The education, the social emotional health, we can begin to address that. I think we're trying to address it as we speak. There are so many opportunities to out there. If people would reach out to their social workers, they would find places to get their kids help. So that's really all I wanted to say. I think we keep moving forward the way we have been is the only way that we can, because we're doing it because public health is the center.
Thank you, Ms. Peel. Mr. Carubas.
No questions or comments.
Thank you, Mr. Carubas. I had a lot of questions and I had a lot of comments, but it has been diminished by my fellow board members. Few thoughts. There's some good news. Good news is that vaccine is going in the arms of people in the United States. Mm-hmm. And we need to have a positive outlook, and returning back to school is important. Our metrics in DuPage and throughout the state, even with Thanksgiving so far, are not as bad as predicted. In fact, look pretty good. We need to continue to be a watchful community. COVID-19 has challenged and frustrated all of us, whether it be students, parents, teachers, board members, superintendents. I know I'm leaving people out, all of us. The Board of Education Administration has received correspondence in unprecedented amounts, offering suggestions and opinions. I was glad to hear, believe it or not, I think we appreciate the diversity of thought. It allows us to challenge ourselves and our process to guarantee that we are exploring all avenues of thought. Throughout this, we said we were going to be fluid. Clearly, a message today is the metrics. Public health is important. I congratulate DuPage County for offering clear metrics when offered, yet realize that Kane, Will, and Lake have different ideas and different thoughts. There is inconsistency. We know that. But public health does need to be the center. We need to use evidence-based metrics and evidence-based thought when we make our decisions. I was glad to hear, and I agree, that we are striving to serve our community in the best manner possible. We know that this is a volatile time, that there will be disagreement. We know that as the virus begins to leave us, there will be time needed for recovery and healing. I read something today from Rick Warren, and I think it embodies what we need to do. We do appreciate that diversity, but we all need to be gentle and reasonable with each other, treating each other with dignity and honor. So on behalf of the administration and the Board of Education, I thank everyone who provides us with that correspondence and diversity of thought. Please know we are doing our best. Are there any other comments or questions? With that, we will move on. Thank you. Thank you, staff, for the presentation.
Thank you.
We now move to our action items. I need a motion to approve the 2020 tax levy as presented.
Justin Karubis, I move that the Board of Education approve the 2020 tax levy as presented.
Mark Rising, second.
There is a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, Jeannie, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Karubis.
Yes.
Mr. Rising.
Yes.
Ms. Donahue.
Yes.
Ms. Grover.
Yes.
Mr. Razak.
Yes.
Ms. Peel.
Yes.
Ms. Deming.
Aye.
Motion passes 7-0. Our next action item is to approve policies 4:90, which is student activity and fiduciary funds, and policy 6:310, high school credit for non-district experiences, course substitutions, and re-entering students. Need a motion to approve those policies for first reading.
Susan Deming. Susan Deming.
Susan Deming, I move that we approve policies 4:90, student activity and fiduciary funds, 6:3.10, high school credit for non-district experiences, course substitutions, re-entering students, both for first reading. And, oh, I'm sorry, for first reading, 2.240, board policy development. Sorry about that.
Justin Karubis, second.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
I just have one quick question. I'm not sure if this is for Doug or Dr. Talley. These were primarily updates and changes that came from legal that were advised by, that comes from Illinois Association of School Boards, who pays attention to the changes of the statutes at the state level, correct?
Yes, that is correct.
Thanks.
Any other comments or discussion? Hearing none, Jeannie, please call the roll.
Ms. Deming.
Aye.
Mr. Karubis.
Yes.
Ms. Donahue.
Yes.
Ms. Peel.
Yes.
Mr. Rising.
Yes.
Ms. Grover.
Yes.
Mr. Razak.
Aye. Motion passes. We now move to the discussion portion of our board meeting. Mr. Todd DePaul will present our facilities update this evening. Mr. DePaul, welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, President Razak, board members, Dr. Talley, and all those watching at home. Thank you for allowing me to provide our annual facility update for our 34 active school buildings, an operations center in Indian Plains. Next slide, please. In tonight's presentation, we'll review the process for determining our capital improvement projects, the recap of our major fiscal year 20 and 21 projects, which emphasized our building envelope and our heating and cooling, our review of the fiscal year 21-22 projects, and our next steps for bidding. Next slide, please. Not surprisingly, budget impacts both the amount and the type of projects that can be completed. Once the budget is determined, projects are prioritized based on the following hierarchy. Safety-related items, and in this case, this means correcting an unsafe building or site condition. That's followed by approved curriculum-related needs. Examples of this are two summers ago when the alternative high school program moved from Indian Plains to Wheatland, and last summer when the STEPS program was consolidated at the Burkett campus. It's then followed by our necessary repairs, again, mainly focusing on building envelope, which includes exterior walls, windows, doors. Our heating and cooling, which includes boilers, chillers, air handlers, unit vents, and safety items. And in this case, this addresses school security items. As you recall, the 2018 Community Engagement Committee recommended that security items be included in our capital improvement plan. This is then followed by those items identified during the life safety surveys, which brings our building code, our buildings up to date based on recent code changes. And then aesthetic items. Examples are replacement of ceiling tile, floor tiles, carpet, and interior painting based on materials' useful life. While we haven't been able to do complete building replacements of these items, we have been able to complete smaller scale projects of this type according to the above priorities. So it's not like we completely stopped looking at our flooring or painting, interior painting. It's just not on a wide scale plan where we would come in and do a whole building. Next slide, please. Before we go into the details of this, looking at the chart, the three summer months are highlighted in red print, and that's when our large scale projects can be completed. As you see, they are also, those months are also split between two fiscal years. So as we look at our large scale projects, we have to make sure that we have a budget included in both fiscal years in order to complete a project. Last year at this time, we anticipated that we would be able to do all the projects that are indicated on this slide. But due to unanticipated budget reductions, the number of capital improvement projects had to be reduced. Those projects that were completed focused on the building envelope with 7 masonry projects and 4 roofing projects. All others were deferred and will be brought back up scheduled again based on the priority we talked about a slide ago. The CEC exterior renovation project not only was deferred, but it needed to be rescoped to bring it back into an acceptable budget. The large scale tennis court repair project was also deferred, but it's important to note that we did repair the cracks to make sure that the courts are safe. Next slide, please. Thank you. This slide details those projects that were completed either during fiscal year 20 or 21. As you recall, our projects are divided into 3 categories. Deferred, which identifies projects that would have or should have been scheduled previously, but because the budget could not. Scheduled projects are those that we routinely do. You know, roof leaks are an example of that. We have to repair our leaks, so we know we have to budget a certain amount in each fiscal year. In this particular slide, also, we were scheduled to replace this portion of the flat roof at Scullin. And then special or projects include our security and in past years, our elementary classroom AC project. As you also recall, the last phase of the elementary air conditioning project had to be deferred due to the uncertainty of funds being available due to COVID. Next slide, please. We have a few pictures of some of the projects. This is a tuck pointing that was completed at Still Middle School, as well as a through wall flashing that was completed at Burkett. Completing this will enable us to bid a roofing project at Burkett. This was the first step that had to be done first before we could consider re-roofing Burkett. Next slide, please. These projects were not completed yet. All have been substantially completed, which means the major work is done. Punch list items remain, or we just have to close out and reconcile any allowances or waiting for contractors to submit final paperwork and warranties and so forth. We obviously don't pay them until everything is completed and all the appropriate paperwork and warranties are in place. The only project that is actively ongoing is a Wabanse Valley High School building automation system upgrade, which is not scheduled for completion until April of 2021. And that project is moving along on schedule. As I said, punch list items are being completed, and I anticipate final payments to be made out in these projects either later in January or February at the latest. Next slide, please. A couple pictures of our roofing project at Brooks, the flat roof replacement at Brooks and the slope roofing replacement project at May Watts. Next slide, please. As we look at our proposed projects for fiscal year 21 and 22, the $3 million that was allocated for fiscal year 2021 will close out those projects that were awarded last spring. Again, looking at the chart, we normally start new projects in June, but due to the fact that we only had $3 million allocated for fiscal year 21, we won't be able to start any new projects until July 1st. So we're looking at projects that either can be completed in 4 to 6 weeks or that can occur on second shift when school's in session. As the proposed projects, we have a mix of deferred security projects and other scheduled projects, as you can see there. The replacement of toilet partitions, fire alarm, and building automation system upgrades at some of our other schools were on the deferred plan from previous years. And again, we feel that we can get those done with the monies allocated for fiscal year 22. The intercom project, we hope to have started last year, but had to be deferred. This is something that the Citizens Engagement Committee wanted us to prioritize, and we will be able to do that as well as look at remote vestibules where we are scanning the licenses in the vestibule before, instead of in the main offices where we are currently doing it. We wanted to pilot this last spring, but was interrupted by the pandemic. So we're looking to go ahead with that project, assuming we have a successful pilot. And then our scheduled projects, we have roof leaks that we need to take care of. The encouraging fact that this past year is that the number of roof leaks or the amount of money we spent on roof leaks decreased from past years. That's a reversal. And again, that indicates that we're making progress on our roofing. And it's helping us not having to spend money to repair leaks. Life safety work will have a certain amount scheduled that we can do. Replacement vehicles, we have 18 vehicles that are used by our delivery, maintenance, and ground staff. Currently, 9 of those have, or nine vehicles have 150 miles or more, and two of those over 200,000 miles. So we're looking to replace, needing to replace one or two of those vehicles. We are continuing with our LED exterior light replacement. And as again, the major construction season, June, July, and August, we need to have a certain amount of money that we can start up our projects on June 1st of 2022. So we have monies available for roof replacements, tug pointing, and asphalt, again, based on our hierarchy as we determine what projects we will be proposing. Next slide, please. Energy management initiatives. As you recall, the demand response incentive program pays us to decrease our energy use when the draw on the electrical grid is so great that it may cause brownouts or blackouts. Only those schools in the ComEd territory are eligible for this program. We have enrolled five of our schools, Fisher, Granger, Still, Mattia, and Wabansi. Our participation is optional, and we won't participate if school's in session. So when there's a critical day determined by the electrical grid, they would contact us to reduce our electrical load. This is the third year that we've been in the program. This has not occurred at any time, but we are still able to get our incentives by participating in the annual 1 hour test. And our 3 year total of monies that we've been paid for that is, as you can see, over $184,000. We also continue to transition our outside lighting from the original installed metal halide or high pressure sodium lighting to energy efficient LED lighting. We're probably about 70% done with that project. And again, that will help us long-term in our energy bills, as well as not having to replace those bulbs as often. Next slide, please. Our next steps for bidding, while we're not scheduled for any large scale projects for the summer of 2021, we will be requesting time and material bids, so we will have a contractor identified to make smaller scale repairs as needed. Primarily, these will focus on our exterior walls and flooring. This will allow us to quickly address safety and other repair issues. We currently have done this in the past. We have this for concrete also. We'll have these bids for an initial term of 3 years with an annual increase based on the December CPI. And then the district could also have the option extending for additional 2 years. And this predominantly will be for building envelope repairs, exterior walls repairs, floor tile and carpet, to make sure that we don't have any unsafe conditions or if we have a need for small scale repairs. Again, we'll have contractors identified and ready to go. Next slide, please. And at that, I will take any questions.
I have a question. Todd, can you share what tuck pointing means?
Yeah, it's basically on a masonry wall where you have to grind out the old mortar and replace it with new mortar. So it's a grinding process and then reforming the mortar joint between the bricks.
That's good. Okay, thank you. I just had no clue. Thanks.
Sure.
Thank you, Ms. Deming. Other questions or comments? I don't hear any. So with that, is there a question?
I guess I was going to ask. I mean, I know our budget is down again. Are we digging ourselves into a giant hole here versus you know, what we should be spending, or, you know, it's like the, you talked about patching the tennis courts and things instead of replacing them. It's like, you know, how much more of that can we do? Or are we going to fall off a cliff here pretty soon?
Well, I think we want to be in a position where we make repairs that are necessary. With budgets being reduced, maybe for the next couple of years, and I don't want to step on Mr. Strang's toes or Mr. Shipley's, but they have a spending plan that they're looking at. The overall plan for the district capital improvements is only a small portion of that. We can continue to, we have to live within our budget, and we're in a position where we can make these small scale repairs for a number of years, but we can't go too far without a bigger payday coming up. And I know both Jay and Matt are aware of that and are budgeting appropriately.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, Todd, I just wanted to say too, you know, I know we just kind of pivoted on you in anticipation of budget constraints we were going to have, and for you to kind of rework the plan, you know, in 3-4 months is quite remarkable. You know, it's a shame because we were able to start to not spend nowhere near, as Ms. Donahue had mentioned earlier, not get to the level of spending on our maintenance that the consulting company said we should be, just because of our budget. We haven't been able to get there, but we were able to do a little bit of catching up, and now we're kind of back down a little bit. I'm at least excited to see we are not, which we can make the argument, you know, back in the lean days of the extreme zero CPIs, where we were almost doing things at a break fix level. You know, I'm glad we're able to accomplish a little here, but, you know, just based on your, you know, your hierarchy that you mentioned earlier, you know, those aesthetic things are kind of coming last, and you know, the safety things are coming first. So I just wanted to make it a point to compliment you, because I know as a board in a district, we had to take a little bit of a different detour because of anticipation finances. So thanks.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions or comments? Thank you, Mr. DePaul.
You're welcome.
There is no report for legislative advocacy update. Have board members anything to add in terms of legislation? Hearing none, last discussion item is Board of Education update. I know on behalf of the board, I didn't think we thank Linda Rakestraw for her service with us during the beginning of this school year. She was a great employee for us when she was working with us on a full-time basis. She took time away from her retirement and assisted us during this most difficult time. As Dr. Talley mentioned, Adam has done a wonderful job as our technology director. He's continued to work. What I remember him best for is getting us to one-to-one in almost a seamless manner. And given that we have 28,000 students, that's no small task. Everything that he touched, he did in a seamless manner. So we really want to thank Adam for his service to the district also. I want to thank our community relations director, IPPC, IPEF, and all our community partners who really assisted and continue to assist throughout the year, not only during the holiday time, to help those parents and families that are in need. It is with a good heart that they do that. And on behalf of the board, it's really appreciated. Finally, I want to thank all our high schools for inviting us to all their winter holiday events. Yes, they're virtual, but I have to tell you, your events readjust my attitude every time I participate in a very, very good way. And so on behalf of the board, thank you for continuing to think of us. Those invitations do more than you know. I have nothing else in terms of Board of Education updates. Anyone else?
Happy holidays.
There you go.
Justin Carubis, motion to adjourn.
Okay. That's Ms. Deming with the second. So I have a motion and a second to adjourn. All in favor, please say aye.
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 Meeting adjourned.